Hi and welcome. We'll have a look at how to create four effects to use on UI elements in this tutorial. First, turning a sprite into a tweakable grayscale version we can further customize, tinting it with a chosen color, animating a gradient over it, as well as displaying a whole gradient all at once. We will also see how to customize the effect through a script, for example, switching over to displaying the basic sprite again when the player hovers over it. And for gradient versions, I'll cover how you can customize the gradient inside the inspector by working with a helper script. You won't need any prior knowledge in Shadergraph to follow along, but I am quite sure you'll be off and explore what else you can do once this tutorial is over. To start, you will need to prepare a canvas with an image object and set up a sprite of choice to be displayed in it. The effect will be a material which uses a custom Shadergraph. So to take one step after the other, right-click on your project window and create a new Shadergraph, URP, Canvas Shadergraph object. Then right-click on the new file and pick Create Material. Rename it to something memorable, then attach it to the UI image like this. Double-click the Shadergraph object to open it and zoom out a little. I docked my scene view next to it, so I can see changes I make here on the UI element directly. First, we need a reference to our main texture. That's the source sprite we set up in the image. Create a new texture 2D entry here by clicking on the plus and picking it from the list. Name it main text. Save the graph with Ctrl plus S and have a look at what the inspector for the UI image looks like now. When you expand the material block, you can see there is an empty box for the source sprite. But we don't need to set it here. By naming it main text, the material will automatically grab the sprite of the image. So let's get rid of this field. Needless fields are just visual clutter and will lead to problems down the line. When you click on the entry in the list, you can see it has been given a name with an underscore, which we can later use in our script. You can also set up a default sprite here, which is useful to do, so you have a somewhat of a preview image inside your Shadergraph. I will set the same sprite I use for the image, but you can really just pick whichever you want. Afterwards, untick the checkbox that displays the field in the inspector and save again. The material block looks empty again. Let's start building the graph. Begin by dragging the main text to the empty space and keep a bit of a distance to the rightmost block. Textures can't just be used as they are, they need to be sampled. So drag out the red dot here, let go of it, and enter Sample into the search bar of the context menu popping up. Connect the alpha of the sampler to the alpha of the vertex to keep the transparency of your image. Turning any kind of color image into a grayscale typically means you would have to reduce the saturation to zero. That leaves behind just the gray values. And this is easily done in Shadergraph too. Grab the dot for RGBA4, drag it to the right, and after letting go, search for saturation. It will connect to the in field here. The saturation value we are looking for is 0. You can already see the effect in the preview of the node. Now connect the out to the vertex base color and save your graph. Your image should come up as grayscale now. However, any artist worth their salt will tell you that just reducing the saturation is hardly enough to get a good grayscale effect. Most of the time, your result needs a bit more tweaking in its color channels to get the most optimal effect. Let's get back to the graph for this and click on the connection between the sampler and the saturation node, then hit delete to remove it. Instead, we will work with the three color channels the sampler offers to us, red, green, and blue. Create three new values in the list, red adjustment, green adjustment, blue adjustment. The default value should be 1 every time. Next, drag out the red channel and search for contrast. The sampler connects to it. Drag the red adjustment next to it and connect it to the contrast value field. Repeat this 2 more times for the green and blue channels. Once done, tap your spacebar. That opens up the search box for nodes. We are looking for a combined node. position it behind the contrast block we built, and connect the three nodes to it. Alpha can be zero, it gets discarded anyway. Select the eight nodes by either opening a rectangle around them or shift-clicking each one. Then group them together with Ctrl plus G. This is the Turn to Grayscale block. To check what this all does, connect the combined value to the base color and save your graph. In the inspector, you can now change the intensity of your specified color channels. That typically looks a little wonky when working with colors, but you should be able to see that you can make areas darker and lighter, depending on the values you choose. Back in the graph, connect the RGB3 out to the saturation node and connect that one's out to the base color. Save again and give those adjustments a few more tries to get a feel for what you might go for. You typically have to make adjustments to each sprite individually, at least as long as they are very different to one another. I can reuse the values I set up here across all of my guinea pig emotes because they share the same color palette. But if I switch to a different sprite, the values won't translate well. So if you want to use this on multiple different sprites, make sure to duplicate the material the needed amount of times and assign it to the image. You can also create a new instance of the material through script, but we will look at that once we get to the script writing part of the tutorial. Before we tackle the tinting effect, let's finish this graph first by adding a check for if the player hovers over the image, and if they do, remove the grayscale effect and display the original colors again. You can obviously have the opposite happen as well. Create a new value inside the graph, and this time we are going for a bool. Call it hovers, and drag it somewhere around here on your graph. Drag its value to the right and search for branch. That node lets you check a value and make a choice depending on what it finds. If the player hovers, we want to display the original colors. Grab the original RGBA4 entry and connect it to the true slot of the new node. For false, connect the result of the saturation node. The result of this block gets linked to the base color once again. Save the result and check in the inspector. You can now toggle the grayscale on and off by taking the corresponding checkmark. Awesome, let's tackle changing these values through script next. Create a new script and call it Changes Material Effect on Hover. It needs to use iPointer Enter and iPointer Exit interfaces, as those check for the required states. Give it a reference to the image at the top and get it in reset. In OnPointerEnter, you set the value of the bool inside the material like this. Make sure you are using the exact way it is spelled inside, with the underscore and name of the value. We cannot set a bool directly, but we can translate it to 0 for false and 1 for true, so that's what we need to do here. In OnPointerExit, we do the reverse. Attach your script and duplicate your image. Then move it a bit to the side and enter play mode. You can see the image correctly interacting with the mouse, but the effect is visible on all images that share this specific material. Exit play mode again and return to the script. Instead of changing the values of the referenced material, we instead need to create a new instance of the referenced material and assign it to the image. Save this and head back to the play mode to test it. With all of this being done and prepared, creating the tinting effect will take hardly any time at all. And if you enjoyed the tutorial so far, please give it a like and consider subscribing. And are you looking for a specific UI effect? Let me know in the comments, maybe I'll be able to add it to my list of tutorials to make. Duplicate your Shadergraph file and rename it to Tinting. Create a new material like you did before by right-clicking on it and choosing Create Material. Assign this material to one of the images in your scene, then open the shader graph and make sure it's the correct one. Tinting only requires one new value and node. Add a color value to the box and set its default value to something that is not directly black or white. It happened way too often to me that I thought I broke something when I did this. Blue or purple works great. Move your grayscale group a bit to the left and tap spacebar. search for the Blend node and move it to the right of the group. This node handles how color is being applied to color values it is being set up with. The out of aura saturation now runs into the source of the blend node, and the tinting color is used for the blend value. I will keep the opacity by 1, but make sure to experiment a little with it and see if that's something you might want to be able to customize in your own material. You know how to create new values already? Just create a new float to hook up to this if that's your path forward. The blend node gives a ton of blend modes, and the one that gives the best results for this effect is the multiply or overlay mode. Feel free to experiment with the blend modes. You can create a ton of great effects with this, just can't really set the mode outside of the shader graph. If you find anything you like, you'll have to create a duplicate of this and create a new material for it, just as we did when creating this tinting effect in the first place. To finish this up, connect the out to the false entry point of the branch that checks for hovering. Save it and give it a test. And next up, let's see what we need to do so we can have a gradient blend with a base instead of a single color. We will check two different versions, one that throws your sprite into party mode and a second one that will just display a whole gradient over it. These take a few more steps, but are only a little bit more complex. Start by duplicating the shader graph once again, then create a new material from it to assign to the image in your scene. Then open the new graph and make sure you really are working on the new one. I stress this because it happens constantly that I suddenly find myself working in previous versions. Start by adding a gradient to the list of values and give it a gradient as its default value. Your first idea might be to connect its out to the blend of the blend node, but just like with textures, gradients need to be sampled before we can do anything with them. Thus, drag out the dot, let go, and search for sample. This node's value can now replace the blend value of the blend node. Since we are not working with a simple color anymore, remove it from the board by selecting it and tapping delete on your keyboard. Also remove it from the list of values available to the user of the material. You should have noticed that instead of seeing the whole gradient, we only see a single color, and overall it feels like it's acting like our previous version of the shader. This is where we need to look at the time value of our gradient sampler. It lets us pick a time and it will sample the gradient at that specific time, giving us a single color. But we can do a few cool things with this. Let's attach a time node to it. Tap your spacebar and search for time. You can connect the first time output to the time value. This will run through all the colors of your gradient exactly once and will leave your sprite tinted with the last color inside your gradient. Instead, let's pick sine time, which will ping-pong through the gradient in a never-ending loop. The party transition being done, let's settle down again and check how we can instead just display the whole gradient itself. And if you are sitting there and going, wait, why can't I change the gradient in the material? Why isn't it showing up? I will get there in a moment. You know the drill by now. Duplicate the shader graph, create a new material from it, attach it to the image. Then open the new one. Remove the time node and any values you added to work with it. Instead, tap your spacebar and search for UV, because even though it's labeled as time, we can totally add a UV output to it instead. If you save it now, you will see the gradient blending with the grayscale sprite. And again, I recommend giving the blend modes a few tries to see what you can do now. But I will stick with overlay here. And this is a great gradient, but I think we are missing the feature to rotate that gradient around. So tap your spacebar once again and search for rotate. Connect the UV to the UV value, keep the center as it is, and connect the out to the time input of the gradient sampler. Add a float value called rotation and connect it to the corresponding value of the node. But since we can actually tell that we are looking for some value between 0 and 360, We can turn this one into a slider with these values as minimum and maximum. And since we are working with degrees here, we need to change the rotations node's units to take degrees instead of radians. Give it a test in the inspector. And finally, we need to address the troubles of not being able to assign gradients in the inspector. You can see it by the green dots in your list, which values are exposed and can be tinkered with. We set our main text to hidden all the way back when this tutorial started, so it is lacking the green dot. But our gradient doesn't even offer the checkbox to expose it. So we need to create a small workaround. Again, duplicate your graph, create a new material, attach the material, open the new graph. Get rid of the gradient in the list and remove this part from your board as well. Instead, create a new value for a texture 2D and call it gradient. Do not expose it in the inspector, or it will confuse you if you want to reuse this in a future project in a few weeks or months. Leave the preview image empty and position it and its sampler node where the real gradient was located a moment ago. Reconnect the rotation output to the UV entry. At least we won't have to pretend our UV rotation is time now anymore. And then the RGBA output value to the blend input of the blend mode. Your sprite will lighten up considerably, but that's alright. Save your material. Now create a new script and call it change gradient of material. It's just a simple mono behavior, but will also give the user a gradient to set in the inspector as well as a step value, which will determine how many colors from the gradient we want to sample. It'll be clear in just a moment what this means. In onValidate, we will create a very simple new texture. Just a pixel high with as many pixels in width as you set in step. This new texture will then be sent to the material to use as its gradient. Attach it to the image to see what it does in action. And if your step is just 2, it will sample the first color of your gradient and your last one. If you pick 3, it will add the center color of the gradient between the two. The higher your step value, the more samples are being taken, leading to a much smoother gradient. But keep in mind that this could have a toll on performance. I haven't run into anything I would have to optimize for with this method yet, but maybe try keeping its value small enough to get the desired effect, and not go crazy and enter something like 10,000 and more into it. Alright, now you have a bunch of new shaders to play around with. I really enjoyed working on this. Shadergraph is an amazing tool and can lead to awesome late-night rabbit hole exploration tours. And if you like this, maybe my tutorial on masks would be interesting to you as well. It covers soft and inverted masks that use Shadergraph materials as well. Hope you enjoyed this. Have a great week.